When you look at the big picture, Miles Davis and Marty Stuart have a lot in common. Bonnie Raitt comes to mind as well. Like Marty Stuart, both Miles Davis and Bonnie Raitt played their first professional gigs with their heroes, artists who were foundational to their respective genres. Miles Davis getting his start with Charlie Parker, and Bonnie Raitt playing one of her first shows with Mississippi Fred McDowell. For Marty Stuart, he joined Lester Flatt's band at the age of 13, before going on to become a member of Johnny Cash's band and eventually striking out to become a hitmaker himself. Very few artists have enjoyed the kind of career that Marty Stuart has, from the overall arc of having one foot in an era which birthed bluegrass and country music and the other in the era which succeeded it. Nor have many music artists succeeded on so many levels as he has, let alone for five decades. In the time we have on this episode, we could spend all of it simply listing and describing his album credits, collaborations, his accolades and awards, as well as his many other credits in film, television, and his work in cultural preservation. Marty Stuart touches on some of these milestones in the conversation we had before his performance in Lenoir, North Carolina, including its time with Lester Flatt and Lester's longtime bandmate and fellow icon Earl Scruggs, his friendship with Rock and Roll Hall of Famer Tom Petty, how being part of the Byrds reunion tour remains a personal top 10 experience in his life, and much more. Also, we welcome classic country and bluegrass DJ and founding member of the Austin Lounge Lizards, Tom Pittman, to the show. I'm your host, Joe Kendrick. Welcome to Southern Songs and Stories with our episode on Marty Stuart and his fabulous superlatives. Southern Songs and Stories is a proud part of the lineup at both Public Radio WNCW and Osiris Media, the leading storyteller in music. Follow Southern Songs and Stories wherever you follow podcasts, with more at southernsongsandstories.com. You can engage with us on social media. Southern Songs and Stories is on Facebook at Southern Songs and Stories, on Instagram at South Stories, and my YouTube channel is Joe Kendrick NC. I'll be honest, Marty Stuart is about as big a fish as I've ever landed for this podcast, so my pressure gauge was going to be high coming into this interview no matter what. But wouldn't you know, the day that I went to interview him, I was delayed a bit in leaving for what I expected to be an hour and a half drive, but was delayed much more when I ran into the seemingly endless construction on Interstate 26 coming into Asheville, North Carolina, where I was to rendezvous with Tom Pittman and his wife Catherine, before heading to the venue in Lenoir, where we would talk with Marty Stuart and then see his show. So I was late, which almost never happens, but just by 10 minutes, and luckily Marty Stuart and his team were okay with that, which put me and Tom back at ease once we arrived. It may have been a stutter start, but the interview itself went quite smoothly. We'll let you be the judge of that. Marty Stuart and his fabulous superlatives are headliners at the upcoming 2024 Earl Scruggs Music Festival in nearby Tryon, North Carolina, so I began our conversation by asking about his time with Earl Scruggs and Earl's impact on his music. Here's Marty Stuart.
Well, Earl, you know, it was like family. And Lester Flatt, Earl Scruggs, and the Foggy Mountain Boys, they were like family to us in our living room down in Mississippi by way of their television show and their recordings. The first two records I ever owned in my life was a Johnny Cash record and a Flatt and Scruggs record. And it's that deep. And of course, Lester gave me a job when I was 13, and he and Earl had split up a couple of years before. So there was, you know, bickering and silence in between them at that point. But, you know, after I got to know Earl, it's like they were really the same guy, just different sides of the mountain. Mm-hmm. They helped invent each other. And what they both did is they were great architects, musical architects. They were pioneers that helped create the road we all travel on today. And I tell you, it still works because when I get down in the dumps or whatever, I get on YouTube and I watch Lester Flatt, Earl Scruggs, and the Foggy Mountain Boys, some of their old TV shows. Everything's all right. The sun comes back out after that. And I'm really proud of what's going on in Shelby. We played the first concert at the Don Gibson Theater. And the Scruggs Center was just kind of, you know, a dream at that point. And the courthouse there is beautiful now, of course, and the programming is great. And Shelby has been a beacon to me because we're doing the same thing in my hometown. We're building a cultural center called the Congress of Country Music. And, boy, if you want to do something, if you run out of anything to do, go put one of those places in the middle of Mississippi or North Carolina. It's like putting a spaceship down. But there is a rhythm to it, and if it's supposed to happen, it usually does, and the right people come around. But I'm really proud of the Scruggs Center and the Don Gibson Center in Shelby because, you know, I've used them a lot of times as an example to folks in Mississippi. It's like, they're doing this in Carolina, and it can be done. So it's been a good time.
Well, talking about the Congress of Country Music, I just love that title for the museum. Can you update us on how things are going? I mean, that's a pretty large facility. It's like the square footage is going to be a lot. Am I right?
It's about a city block. And the cornerstone is the old city theater, the Ellis Theater, which is up and running for about a year and a half now. People are playing there and filling it up. It's only a 500-seat theater, but it's beautiful. And the rest of the campus is being drawn right now. Money's in the bank, pretty much. State has been a great partner. And so I think by the end of the year, dust will start flying down there.
How is it that you got into the habit of collecting this much memorabilia? Because this is the largest private collection of country music artifacts in the world. Am I right?
So I'm told. The insurance bill could prove that. But I was always a fan. As a kid, gospel quartets or, you know, country bands would come through my town occasionally. And to get an autograph or a signed album or a guitar pick from one of the musicians, that was my thing. And it just, I put it all in my bedroom when I was a kid. It was like I thought it was the museum. It was treasures from a world I wanted to be a part of. And when I first went to work in Nashville, I would see Lester, for instance, take off his tie because it had too much makeup on it, too many TV shows, throw it in the garbage. Can I have that? Or he'd write out a set list and wad it up and throw it in the garbage. Can I have that? It started like that. It just looked important, too important to throw away. But in the early 80s, everything started changing in Nashville when the Urban Cowboy movie hit. The look, feel changed, cast, everything about country music changed. And all of a sudden, the old timers were kind of put out in the pasture because they weren't young and hip and cool anymore to that world. And I had a foot in both worlds. Those are the people that raised me that I loved, but I was also young and, you know, trying to make whippersnapper music. But all of a sudden, those treasures from those people started winding up in junk stores and thrift shops around Nashville. First thing I found that really turned my head around was a $75 hand tool, like a Western saddle. It was a train case, a lady's makeup case, and it had Patsy Cline on the front of it. This is wrong. So it was just really about rescuing things that were precious, like family treasures. Like it'd be like walking into a thrift store and seeing your mama's, you know, purse or something. It's like, that can't be. You gotta take it home. So it started like that. It started in my bedroom and then a little warehouses, and now there's a cultural center being built around it.
Tell us about that generation of players. Like you mentioned in the 80s, that was the sea change moment, a kind of a shift in eras. Maybe comment on where we are now, where you see these generations that are coming into the forefront now versus, you know, just how many, you know, icons that you've worked with. You know, Vassar and Doc and Earl and Johnny Cash and on and on. If you have any observations about that generation compared to who's coming up.
Everything about the face value of country music changes every Monday morning. Starting with the Bristol Sessions in 1924, it was about evolving, becoming accepted by the world, which country music pretty much has now. And it's hard to go tell a kid who's filling up a stadium, you're doing something wrong. You know, that's not how it works. So I find my place where I believe and I know that I fit in and I stand there. And I like the timeless era, the timeless end of country music, the divinely ordered, you know, bedrock of country music. But the thing that I find in common that has never changed is bluegrass festivals, because that's where people like myself, Jerry Douglas, Sam Bush, Vince Gill, Travis Tritt, Mark O'Connor, we all learned to play alongside of our heroes on stage or at campfire pickings at bluegrass festivals because it was accessible. It was like a big classroom. And the thing about it is it's really cool if you go to Merlefest or wherever, those people like me and that my generation of people that learn from those old masters, they're not teaching a bunch of young kids. You know, Sam's Bill Monroe now or whatever. You know, I see a young guy like Wyatt Ellis playing the mandolin. He's, you know, looking. But there's always a new crop of kids that pick and sing and write. And bluegrass festivals are a wonderful, authentic place to find your voice and to lift off from.
I'd like you to meet one of the greatest banjo players on planet Earth. Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Charlie Cushman. Hey, take a bow, Charles. You want to do it over there, over here? You're on. What you got for us? Shuckin' the well-known corn. In the key of G major, ladies and gentlemen.
Speaking of live bluegrass, that's the Flatt and Scruggs composition Shuckin' the Corn from Marty Stuart and his Fabulous Superlatives album Live at the Ryman, recorded in 2003. As you heard Marty introduce him, that was Charlie Cushman playing banjo, and it's noteworthy that Charlie and Marty have a similar trajectory with the beginning of their careers, both of which began incredibly early in life. For Marty, he made his professional debut on that same stage at the age of 13, as a member of Lester Flatt's band, Nashville Grass, having been introduced to Lester Flatt by Nashville Grass mandolinist Roland White, who discovered Stuart a year earlier when he was playing in the gospel group The Sullivans. Charlie Cushman was fascinated by bluegrass from the age of 4, and his Saturday afternoons were filled with TV shows on WSM from Nashville, The Ernest Tubbs Show, The Wilburn Brothers Show, The Porter Wagoner Show, The Grand Ole Opry, and his favorite, the Flatt and Scruggs Show. It didn't take long for him to pick up the banjo, and by the age of 10, he was playing on radio station WPHC in Waverly, Tennessee, each Saturday night on the live broadcasts of the Tennessee Valley Jamboree. For both Charlie Cushman and Marty Stuart, the die was cast very early. While Charlie Cushman has played bluegrass throughout his career, Marty Stuart's next high-profile gig after Lester Flatt retired in 1978 was in country icon Johnny Cash's band in 1980. And country music is what comes to mind to so many people with Marty Stuart, who came to fame as a Nashville hitmaker in the mid-1980s and early 90s. He frequently collaborated with country star Travis Tritt, with whom he won his first Grammy Award and first Country Music Association Award in 1992. there would be many more nominations yielding a variety of awards in years to come, both Grammy and Country Music Association awards, as well as the Academy of Country Music, International Bluegrass Music Association, Americana Music Honors and Awards, and the Golden Globe Awards. While he and the Fabulous Superlatives play plenty of acoustic shows and dip into their bluegrass songbook regularly, Marty Stuart's main mode of musical expression is now electric, and leans in the direction of country rock pioneered by the Byrds and Graham Parsons, as you can hear on this song from their 2023 album Altitude, titled Vegas.
Today I rode a lucky seven, bought a turquoise Cadillac. Going home tomorrow, but I'll be coming back to Vegas, to Las Vegas.
In a pretty sweet spot now musically. I mean, the fashion, it's probably not fair to call it a fashion, but cosmic country is a big deal now, and it seems like you've never really wavered from that as much as the hour hand has come back around to you in that sense.
I don't even know what the word means, cosmic. It's out there, I guess. But everybody I've known, including me, we've always been out there. You have to be out there to be a musician and to really tune in and do the right stuff. Bill Monroe was out there. Flatt and Scruggs were out there. The Stanley Brothers were as out there as you could get, whatever out there means. It's not drugs and alcohol to me. It's a way of thinking. It's a way of thinking. And to be totally open and accept all strands of music and turn it into something that hopefully becomes an authentic strand of American music.
When you did the Busy Bee Cafe album, you had a couple of Lester Flatt numbers. Do you ever play any Lester Flatt numbers or any of that Flatt and Scruggs material?
When we had our TV show, I think we did a couple of Flatt and Scruggs songs, but quite honestly, they're a little too close to my heart. I still hear Lester singing them and Earl playing them, and I feel like it's kind of sacred territory that I don't need to impose upon. I do better listening to it than I do playing it. There was only one of them. It's kind of like Johnny Cash. When I was in Johnny Cash's band, we used to comment, anybody can be Elvis because there's a lot of Elvis impersonators, but nobody can authentically be a Johnny Cash act, and pretty much that's still, there's a lot of people trying, but John was a once-in-a-lifetime character. Flatt and Scruggs are a once-in-a-lifetime band. Everybody plays their songs, but nobody plays them quite like them. So I think I tend to shy away from it for that reason.
Well, you've got the Tom Petty cover, which is pretty new, I Need to Know. So that's got to be firmly in your wheelhouse. I mean, who doesn't love Tom Petty? But is there, like you say, Flatt and Scruggs is a little too close to your heart to really take it on? Are there other artists that you would like to cover, or maybe somebody else that you haven't covered yet?
The thing that I find out, the deeper I get, is that some songs ought to be left alone.
Well, not left alone, but listened to.
Listened to, that's a good way to put it. Tom Petty was a buddy of mine. The Heartbreakers were North Star, you know, kind of big brothers to me and the Superlatives. And when that project came around, I remember a conversation that Tom and I had one time, and he said, you know, what about that country music? He talked about how kind of real rock and roll kind of disappeared. Yeah, he said, there's no great real rock and roll much left anymore. I said, well, we have the same problem with country music. He says, yeah, country music kind of sounds like bad rock and roll with a fiddle to me. I went, that's a pretty good analogy. So when this project came around, I went, I don't know if we should take on a Heartbreaker song, but Mike Campbell, his guitar player, kind of gave us his blessing. I'm like, all right, Campbell thinks it's all right. We'll give it a crack. So I think the track turned out pretty good.
Well, the talk on the street says you might go solo.
Maybe we can talk about your band a little bit, Marty. I know Tom is fairly good friends with Chris, and the Superlatives, I mean, that says it all. They are fabulous.
They're both fabulous and superlative.
Yeah, can you brag on your band a little bit?
Oh, absolutely. That's no problem. we were talking on the way over here with a lady, Kimberly, who is one of the directors here. And we're talking about going to school. Chris Scruggs has a son named Ben who's 9 years old, who I'm convinced it takes one to know one. He wouldn't go to school a day in his life if he could just get on the bus and play the guitar. I know that look because I'm one of those characters. I mean, I was practicing my autograph in the third grade. Started my first band when I was 9. So band life I get. And when I was in school, I really didn't know much about algebra, but I could tell you who was in Merle Haggard's band and what kind of guitars they played, or the Buckaroos, or Johnny Cash's band, or Flatt and Scruggs when they were together, Bill Monroe's band. You know, I was that student of all that. And I know about bands. And from the first moment that the Superlatives came together, I saw Kenny playing on TV with Lucinda Williams, and I was trying to take a year off, and I thought, look at him. He's like Luther Perkins in Johnny Cash's band. He's a quirky bird that plays his heart out. So the next thing I know, I bump into him and say, let's have lunch. What are you doing? He said, nothing. I went, me either. Let's start a band. Okay. So by the time the check came, my job was to find us a drummer. His job was to find us a bass player. And we worked it out. And we've been together almost 23 years now. And I think, I'm bragging here, but those bands I mentioned a minute ago, put the Beatles and the Rolling Stones and Tom Petty and the Heartbreakers and whoever else alongside of that. But people that had the privilege of seeing those bands, I think 20 years later, went, I got to see those guys one time. And it made a difference. It might be all my brothers, you know, those kind of Grateful Dead, whoever. And they carry that with them for the rest of their life and they talk about it.
I saw Flatt and Scruggs in 1969, little realizing that they were on the verge of breaking up. But I am so proud of that I got, I'm very few people that I know got to see Flatt and Scruggs.
Right.
They broke up before most of them were born. But okay. I got to see them one time.
Case in point, Tom's talking about it. And I think the Superlatives are one of those bands someday people go, but I got to see those guys one time. And it was a good night or a bad night, but I got to see them. I think bands are like football or baseball or hockey teams. It's a way for people to invest in, and it's an escape. You can hang your hopes and dreams on the right band and watch them, you know, go flying and hope they keep it going for a while. It's a good morale booster for people.
I remember hearing about the Fabulous Superlatives, and to me it was sort of like the first time I saw Richard Thompson. Mm. Everybody, there was a magazine back then called, what was it called? Folk Music Magazine. It was just always raving about them. I thought, nobody's that good. I got to see him up in Edmonton, Alberta. Mm. And I said, I'm going to go over there and I'm going to watch this. And it wasn't long before I said, I see. And it was the same way with the Fabulous Superlatives. I got to see the Byrds reunion tour twice.
Did
you? I saw it in, was it Knoxville or Kingsport? Somewhere up there. I saw it,
maybe
Bristol. Bought the tickets for that, but then I happened to be in Austin when it came there, and I thought, wow, there's no way there's going to be a ticket. And I got one.
Great.
And I was totally impressed with that.
I was too.
Chris Scruggs, as I understand it, had never played pedal steel before.
Well, he played some, but that, I think that was the deepest assignment he'd probably ever been
faced. Well, that's about as deep as you can get. Yeah. Trying to be Lloyd Green.
And that tour was magic every night, every single night. And, you know, there's just been a new double album released that's from that tour. That's really good. So if you missed the tour, it's a good way to catch up.
Oh, yeah.
That's another one of those things I'm going to say, I saw that.
I hear you.
Yeah.
I hear you. That's one of my top 10 things that I've ever been a part of.
Oh, my goodness.
It's great.
And it's just hard to realize it was that long ago.
Yeah.
50 years since those recordings were made, and mm-hmm. only two people left alive out of the group, and he went out to look around and see who could fill the bill as being the band, and
we got to be the Byrds.
You got to be Byrds, and you were as good as
everybody. Well, we got to be the Byrds and be, you know, like we were when we were kids. Yeah. And playing that music, and Roger and Chris got to be Roger and Chris and didn't have to put up with a band.
Yeah.
So everybody left at the end of the night happy.
Yeah.
So it was great. No drama. Great music.
I just was stunned at how well your guitar playing in particular. I thought you spent some time
I had to go back to the woodshed.
It lived
in my head, but I had to really bond up.
If I'd had my eyes closed, it could have been Clarence.
I know the difference, but I hope I got close to the spirit of Clarence.
You got totally on the spirit. If a note or two were different, it was inconsequential.
I'm so glad you got to see it.
And I saw it twice, and I came away thinking that both times. Well, he must have spent a lot of time working on that. And it's played on the original guitar, too. Which, you know, those things
the guitar has a bigger following than I do. Everybody wants to see that guitar.
It's like Clarence's guitar.
Yeah, somebody walks up and has that look in her, I just hand it to them. That's what it's for. I share it over.
Well, I'm glad it ended up with you.
Oh, when I first got it, there was a lot of but he don't deserve it, and I was the chief among everybody going, you're exactly right, I don't deserve this guitar, but I happen to have it, so I'm going to have to figure out something to do with it. So his wife, Clarence's wife, Susie, said, Clarence would want you to have this guitar, and you're the right keeper for it. And when she said keeper, that is a big responsibility.
But you're not only a keeper of the instruments, but you're a keeper of the whole music. You know what it ought to be, and you've kept it going.
I love it.
I love it, too.
Yeah.
You're the amongst the people that, well, you're one of the very few that were kind of, as you said, foot in both generations. Of course, you got a very early start, but you were knocking them dead at the very beginning, and you've just been a wonderful student.
And that's what I am. I'm still a student. I'm still a fan, and I think that's what keeps it fresh.
That's what I'm doing. Quite unbeknownst to me, I got asked to interview Peyton Duncan about Ken Burns' series, and I went in there, I hadn't seen anything, you know, I knew what was going on. And one of the first things I said to him, you know, the person that really knows this stuff that you ought to talk to is Marty Stuart. And he said, oh, he's got more on-screen time than anybody. And I was glad to hear that.
Oh, I love Dayton. That show we worked on for 8 years, and it was a labor of love. Because I knew, again, everybody won. Everything Ken touches becomes curriculum. And I knew that it was a great balance for country music. There's so much contemporary country music that makes the pages now. And a lot of the heart, soul, and root stuff doesn't quite get as much ink. But I knew that Ken's presence in our world would serve as a balance. And all of a sudden, we would be in the same air with the Roosevelts and baseball and jazz and Prohibition and the Vietnam War, the national parks. That's the air he travels in. And that's what happened. Country music went up in there and found a whole lot of new people.
Yeah, and I'm so glad he did.
Me too.
Closing out this episode with Marty Stuart and his fabulous superlative song Mojave from the 2017 album Way Out West. Thank you so much for sharing your time with us, and we hope you can help us again by spreading awareness of what we're doing. It's as easy as telling a friend and following this podcast on your platform of choice, both of which are quick, easy, and free. From there, it takes just a moment to give us a top rating and, where it's an option, a review. It makes a great difference because the more top reviews and ratings we get, the more visible we become to everyone on those platforms, which means that more people just like you connect with artists like Marty Stuart and fabulous superlatives Kenny Vaughan, Chris Scruggs, and Harry Stinson. This series is a part of the lineup of both Public Radio WNCW and Osiris Media, with all the Osiris shows available at osirispod.com. You can also hear new episodes on Bluegrass Planet Radio at bluegrassplanetradio.com. Thanks to Tom Pittman for joining in the conversation. You can hear Tom every Sunday morning on Public Radio WNCW on his bluegrass show, The Gospel Truth, followed by his classic country show, Country Gold. Thanks also to Jacqueline Anthony for producing the radio adaptations of this series on Public Radio WNCW, where we worked with Joshua Mink, who wrote and performed our theme songs. I'm your host and producer, Joe Kendrick, and this is Southern Songs and Stories, the music of the South and the artists who make it.